Usually we take this time for prayer time, but due to the fact that I'm got a long message tonight, a really long message. I'm talking about one of them two-day jobs. Thank you, my brother. Thank you. There'll be a little something in your envelope when you leave today. Genesis chapter 12, we're going to look at verses 1 through 9 tonight, and we're going to study about the call of Abram. The call of Abram. Of course, we know who is Abraham. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 9. I'm going to ask you to stand if you can in reverence to the Word of God. And once again, if you cannot stand, God understands that also. But if you can, would you please rise to give respect and reverence to the reading of His Word tonight. Beginning in verse 1 of chapter 12 of the book of Genesis, the Bible says, "Now the Lord said unto Abram, Get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, into a land that I will show thee. And I will make thee a great nation, and will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and I will curse them that curse thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." And Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. And Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance and that they had gathered, and their souls that they had gotten in Haran. And they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and to the land of Canaan they came. And Abram passed through the land into the place of Shechem, into the plains of Moreb, and into the Canaanites, and there was in there in the land. And the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, "Unto thy seed will I give this land, and there build here an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him." And he removed from thence unto the mountain of the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Hai on the east. And there he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed going on still towards the south. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for the wonderful privilege we've had to be hear you, your word proclaimed in song. We thank you, dear God, for David as he wonderfully led us in corporate worship, and then for Brother Gene and Miss Angela as they came and shared their heart in music tonight. And Lord, we pray that you'd lift us up, and you always do, and you make us so much more than we are. And Father, I would pray tonight that your word would be lifted up, that it would come alive in our hearts and our minds as we think about the call of Abram. And Lord, as we equate this to your call upon our lives, for every born-again, blood-washed believer has a call of God on their lives. It may not be to the pastoral ministry or to the preaching ministry. It may be ministering to babies or whatever it may be, but we all have your calling. And I would pray tonight that you would guide our hearts to the truth of your word and how it applies to our lives. And I would ask this in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you for standing in reverence to the word of God tonight as we read that. First, as we look at the scriptures tonight and we see the call of Abram, we understand that as we already looked at the begets this morning and the begets of Shem, where the lineage of Shem, the descendants of Shem, went all the way down to Abram. And of course, we know that Abram's name means father. It means a wonderful father, if you would. And of course, he became the father of all Hebrews. Well, what we see first in verse 1 is what I've noted as a command. God gave a command to Abram, and he says, "And now the Lord had said unto Abram," well, that's pretty much a command if he's talking to him, and he says, "Get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, into a land I will show thee." God has given Abraham, or Abram if you would, a command to leave, something that most people don't like to do. I know in my own life as a pastor, God has called me to leave the comfort zones of my life, just like he did Abram. He told him to leave his country, to leave his traditions, to leave his culture, his customs, and that's not always easy to do when you're set in your way or set there. To leave his birthplace, the place of his kindred. He was called to leave his father's house, and him being there as the firstborn would be the innermost circle where his emotions, as he would sit and hear the wisdom of his father. And God says, "You got to leave all this. I'm telling you to leave all this." Many of you who've been in the military, you understand what moving is about. Those who've been in ministry, we understand what having to move is all about. But some of you have never really moved. You've been in the same place or the same city most of your life, and it is not easy to uproot and to move and to go to different places and experience the different cultures. And you may say, "Well, Pastor Buddy is a pastor. You moved into the United States. You never really moved outside the United States. So how is the culture different? How are traditions different? Until you move to the Delta of the Mississippi, you don't understand cultural differences. Till you move to the mountains of Virginia, where I pastored for 5 years, the cultural differences are just they're unreal. When I first moved to Virginia, I was told, and we were up in the mountains, not in the eastern part of Virginia, but the western part, right near the Kentucky line, right near the West Virginia line. Actually, we were at 4,800 foot elevation above sea level. We were in the mountains. And they told me, they said, "Preacher, here's the deal. If people like you, they'll like you for life. If they hate you, they'll hate you for life." And I found out that wasn't true. Their culture is, if they hate you, they do hate you for life. But if they like you only until they find something to hate you about. Then they dislike you for life. So see, they tried to sham me right off the bat. But the culture are different. And they even spoke different. They'd sing the song, "Are You Washed in the Blood?" I couldn't figure out what washed was for the longest time. I can't even say it. What washed was for the longest time. And hits. I thought hits mean you got hit. But they would say, "Hits all right with me." I said, "Well, hits not all right with me. You're not hitting me and get away with it. I don't appreciate that." It's just different colloquialism, different cultures, different traditions. And here, Abram had to leave his comfort zone, if you would. And he left because God commanded him to do so. And not only is there the aspect of leaving, but the reason of leaving. It was not totally known to Abram. God didn't tell him, "This is why you're going to go." So very often when God leads in our lives and he says, "I want you to go here," then we want to know why. What do you want me to go there for? You want me to go to seminary? You want me to become a missionary? You want me to go because that's where the jobs are? You want me to go because that's where other family members may be? We want to know. We're that analytical, that rational type people. We want to know. How would it be in your life right now if all of a sudden the presence of the Holy Spirit just overshadowed you and you felt the Lord saying, "I want you to go to the deepest part of the Amazon"? I know the first question you'd ask, but apart from "who, me?" would be, "Why? Why do you want me to go?" Well, God doesn't owe us an answer. We owe him our obedience. Amen. We don't see in the scriptures where Abraham said, "Now, wait a minute, God. Let's talk about this for a little bit. Let's reason a little bit. Give me an explanation of why you want me to leave. I got it made here. I'm number one son. I inherit all that my dad has when he finally relinquishes his life, if you would, when he dies. And I have family. I'm used to the culture. I like the food. Everything's all right with me, God. Why in the world do you want me to leave?" We don't see that. God commanded him, didn't give him a reason, and Abram got up and he left. Well, in a way, God did give him a reason, because God promised something that would take place in his life. He didn't give him the full explanation of it, but God promised him something. Notice what God promised him in verse 2. God says, "And I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing." Well, Abraham understood, because he knew who God was. He was taught that. Remember, we studied this morning about the lineage where he came from a man from way up with Shem all the way down, who loved God, who gave him the story about the flood, and he understood the power of God, that he protected Noah and his family for those 365 days and brought them out of that and had protected them all this time and met the needs of their lives. And he understood that God kept his promises. We understand that too, according to the New Testament, out of 2 Peter 3, verse 9, where it says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, but he is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but all men should come to repentance." The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness. In other words, when God makes you a promise, you can absolutely, unequivocally depend upon it, because it's the word of God. And when he promises you something, it doesn't matter what the details are or how you have to go about to achieve it. You just step out on faith and say, "Okay, God, I don't know, but you said it. I'm going to trust you for it," and you move forward. And that's what Abram did. But we also understand that we see the scriptures here, that there is what I call lower blessings and higher blessings. Notice there once again in verse 2, he says, I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless you, and curse them that him that curses thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. Well, the lower blessings is what he got personally. But sometimes we believe that's the higher blessing. Well, God spoke to Abram, and he says, I will make thee a great nation. Now, don't you know that could have went straight to his pride, to his heart, said, I'm going to leave Daddy. Daddy thinks he's the big cheese. God just said he's going to make me a great blessing. He's going to make me the man. He's going to make me all that and everything else. And he said, I'm going to make you a nation of people. Now remember, humanity now is coming throughout the world after the flood, and we see the descendants of Shem, Ham, and Japheth being fruitful and multiplying. And all of a sudden, God tells Abram, I'm going to make you a nation. I'm not going to make you a family. I'm not going to make you a bunch of descendants. I'm not going to make you a city. I'm going to make you a nation. That's a pretty big blessing, isn't it? But it really isn't. It's really a lower blessing. But he also says, and I will bless thee for moving from your birthplace because you will be obedient. Not only am I going to make you a nation where your name will be known and be praised and be lifted up, I'm going to bless you for being obedient to me. I'm going to bless you personally. And then he says to him, I will make thy name great. That compensates for him leaving his father's home, and I'm going to build up your name. I'm going to build up your reputation. I'm going to give you prestige and prominence, and everybody's going to know who Abram is. Remember? Even throughout Scripture, he became Father Abraham, and all the Hebrews, even today, if you were to go to Israel, they'll tell you who Father Abraham is. What a name. Friends, we're talking 6,000 years, 7,000 years ago. And today his name still rings loudly in the hearts of Christians and in the hearts of the Hebrews. That would seem like the highest blessing, wouldn't it? But it's really not. It's the lower blessing. Because that's what Abraham received. But the higher blessings we see there, he says, and I will bless them that bless you. Or he says, and thou shalt be a blessing. See, it's not what we get, it's what we're able to give that makes the blessing the greatest. So very often in life, we get these accolades and we get these pats on the back and folks bless us. And that's a wonderful thing. And I don't want to distract from that or take away from that by any means. But friends, the Bible says it's more blessed to give than to receive. Doesn't it? So when you think about this, I'll make thee a great nation, I will bless thee, I will make thy name great, it sounds really big, but really in the heart of a child of God who puts aside pride in their life, it's not about getting, it's about giving. And God says, and you shall be a blessing, not just for receiving, but being a blessing to others. And then he says, and I will bless them that bless thee, and I will curse them that curse thee. This identifies that Abraham is about God's business. He's not gone out on his own. He's not going off in his father's name. He's not even going off in his own name, which God says, I will make a great name. He's going off in the name of God because why? God commanded him to go. And when we go out in the name of the Father, my dear friends, God will bless those that bless us, and he will curse those that curse us, so we don't have to worry about that. That's why the Bible says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Amen. You ever go out witnessing to some or in a community, and there are those who greet you and say, God bless you, thank you for coming? And all that makes you feel good, doesn't it? And then you ring that doorbell, and the door opens, and they think, oh, Lord, Jehovah's Witness, slam the door right in your face. And you think, curse them, God. Get them, God. You don't have to. God will take care of that. We're supposed to love our enemies. And God says to Abram, he says, I will bless them that bless you. I will curse them that curse you. These are the higher blessings of life. And then we also see in the scripture, it says, in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. Because of his obedience to the command of God, God promised that all the family that would become the nation of Abram will be blessed. Oh, my dear friends, if we were able to do that in our own lives and just live our life in such a way by following the commandments of God and accept his promises that all around us would be blessed, it'd be a glorious thing, wouldn't it? Because of Adam, the ground was cursed. But now, because of Abram, mankind would be blessed. Families would be blessed. I think I got a blessed family. They can be a pain sometimes, but I got a blessed family. Our family has good health. My daughter came through cancer 2 summers ago, and Mother's Day, she will be cancer-free 2 years. She's still a knothead, just like her mama. Boy, I tell you. Y'all can edit that, please. She's probably more like me than her mama. Listen here, sister. But I'm a blessed man. I have a blessed family. We live in the greatest nation of the world. We have food. We have shelter. We have finances. We have the Word of God that we can freely worship. That's the higher blessing. And our families are blessed because of that. So we see the command of God, then we see the promises of God with lower blessings where they come upon him, upon Abram, but the higher blessing is what was come from him to others. And then we see the obedience of Abram. Notice there in verse 5, or beginning in verse 4. And so Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. Friends, I don't think it took a long time for Abram to pack up. I don't think he was mad with his dad. I don't think there was problems in the family. I think this man just walked close enough with God when God said, I'm going to send thee out to a new, different country from your kindred, from your father's house to a land that you don't even know anything about, but I'm going to show you where to go. Abram probably looked over at Sarah and said, all right, start packing. Now, you know that probably was a conversation that went real well. What do you mean start packing? What do you mean? I got all these dishes to pack, and I got everything else to get. And where are we going? Why are we going there? Who told you we got to go there? No, you know she was a wonderful wife, obedient to her husband. But Abraham was obedient. It says, so he departed as the Lord had spoken. We don't see in the scriptures where he questioned God. We don't see in the scriptures where Sarah questioned God. All we know is that God spoke and said, go, and Abram packed up and he went. But not only did he go, the Bible says, and Lot went with him, his nephew. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their substance. Boy, I like that. All their substance. They didn't leave a goat, a chicken, a blanket, or a cup. They took everything that God had told them to take, and he gathered the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth into the land of Canaan, and to the land of Canaan they came. And Abram passed through the land of the place of Shechem and the plain of Moreh, and the Canaanites was in the land. Now that's pretty significant, isn't it? Because the Canaanites, remember, were kind of cursed, were they not? Remember they came from Ham? And they were cursed. Now, wait a minute. God has told Abram to leave his country. Abram was obedient, not knowing where he's going. And God's going to send me to this place with these people who I know because of great, 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 great Uncle Ham are cursed people. And this is where you're going to place me? Isn't it amazing how God always comes and answers the questions of the heart? In verse 7 it says, and the Lord appeared unto him and said, unto thy seed will I give this land, and there build an altar unto the Lord who appeared. There he built an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. If he had worries in his heart. Now, friends, I understand worry. Now, the Bible says, take no thought for tomorrow, for sufficient to the day is the difficulties that we face, basically. But yet God made us with emotions, did he not? Didn't he? So we worry, don't we? He says, don't worry about your height. He made us how high we are. Don't worry about anything else. He takes care of all of our needs. But he made us with emotions, and he makes us we do worry. But God come and he soothed the worries if Abram had them. We don't know that he did, but I would assume that he probably did. But God didn't leave him hanging. He came and appeared unto him and said, thy seed will I give to thee this land. All this land with all the difficulties, with these Canaanites who are evil and against me, God says, I'm going to give you the land. Is not God a God of his promises? And if God told Abram, I'm going to give you this land, and Abram had already believed God to the point where God said, leave all your family and everything else and go to where I tell you to go, even though you don't know. And Abram says, okay. I just really believe. Abram says, okay, Lord. You say this is where you want me to be, and you're going to give me the land of the Canaanites? He believed him to the point that he built an altar there to worship God. Excuse me. And the Bible says, and he removed from there and forth from the mountains of the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent from Bethel on the west and from Hai on the east, and therefore built an altar unto the Lord, and called upon the name of the Lord. Abram obeys God. No questions asked. God, is this what you want? This is what I do. And the Lord spoke to Abram, and Abram built an altar in a place called Bethel. The word Bethel speaks of Beth means house, El means God, means house of God. And when we study in the book of Genesis and we continue to read, and we'll see where Jacob's had his vision, had his dream, we'll see El Bethel, which is God's house of God. Isn't it an amazing day? You ever heard of church's name Bethel? How do they say it? Bethel. They put the emphasis on the house, Bethel, when it should be Bethel, house of God. That's what we see in the scriptures there, isn't it? Abraham built an altar, but he put the emphasis on God, not on the house. Oh, we could take wonderful lessons from that as believers today. And Abram journeyed, going on still towards the south. He didn't stop. He wanted to see all that God had for him because God commanded him to leave. He accepted God's promises by being obedient. Now, one thing we understand was that Abram was not running from God, but he was running to God, because where God wanted him to be is where God was going to be in his life. And too many people today are running from God. We prefer our comfort zones. We prefer our own life instead of stepping out and doing what God has commanded us to do and receiving the promises of God through obedience. We sing that song, Trust and Obey, and it means so very much, but we do so very little of it. Abram understood that if God wanted me way over yonder, y'all do understand yonder, right? Then he knew God was going to be there waiting on him. And he went over there, and if you allow me to freedom here, he went over there and had church. He built an altar at a place called Bethel, house of God. He built an altar. He wasn't going to give up on God. He was going to give into the will of God. I cannot tell you how many folks I've counseled with when God was dealing with their hearts about doing certain things that seemed way out of the norm, way out of the spectrum of their lives, and they question God. And it's okay to question God to a point. Comes a time, folks, when you just got to step out on faith and trust God, not knowing how it's going to work out. But instead of giving up on God and turning their back, we need to surrender to his will for our lives. I have known men that unequivocally said they were called of God to the ministry of the gospel and never do it because it would disrupt their lives too much. It would disrupt their lives too much. Well, you're right. It could easily disrupt the life that you have right now, but there is something better. Because it's better to be in the will of God with disruption than to be in your own will with peace, because that peace won't last. It won't work. There's a call on Abram's life. His call was commanded by God to leave, even though the reasons of it wasn't known to him. But he understood the promises of God, that God would take care of him. And even though God says, I'm going to bless you and make you a great nation and make thy name great, he realized that the greater blessing was coming because he left a footprint, an impact in a lost and a dying world. You see, when God sent him to Canaan, they needed God. He sent him in the middle of the struggle of the evil ones because they needed God. His household was a household of faith. They didn't need God because they had God. It was those who needed God who needed a man of God to come and tell them about his God. And he went there and built a church. And when he got that one built, he moved on, built another one. And he got there, he built and built another one. He was obedient to the call on his life. Well, what is the call of your life tonight? Is your life, the calling of your life, just to come to church on Sunday morning, Sunday night, maybe on Wednesday night? I don't think that's the call on any Christian's life. I think that's a command of God that we should be in the house of God at the appointed time. I believe that with all my heart. Because I believe in Hebrews it says we're not to forsake the assemblies of ourselves together as the manner of some do, but we're to come together and exhort each other, and so much the more as we see the day approaching, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. I believe we are to come together, but this is not just our calling. I believe God's called some of us to be soul winners. I believe Brother Keith has that gift. I believe it with all my heart because he witnesses to everybody he comes in contact with. Shares Christ. Picks up people, strangers. Gets them in that truck. Ask them, do you know Jesus? Are you ready to die and go to heaven? And he stomps it. Their eyes get real big. And then they start, Jesus, Lord Jesus. They may not know him, but they'll call on him, won't they, brother? I say that kiddingly, but this man picks up people and tells them about Christ. Witnesses to them in parking lots. What is your calling? Some may be called to be men and women of comfort. Men and women of servitude. Men and women of giving. And friends, listen, when I say giving, it's not always about financial giving. Sometimes it's giving of self or abilities or in giftedness that God has engifted you with. Tonight we have Brother Gene and Miss Angela come with their in giftedness to give to us. They didn't come to get. Oh, by the way, you're not getting anything. But you have gotten something, haven't you? You got a blessing for being here, and we've been blessed. What's God's calling on your life? And if you don't know, friends, I want to tell you how to find it out. You get in God's Word. You get on your knees before the Father and you say, Lord, I don't know what you want me to do, but I want to know what you want me to do. And if you want me to go, you need but say the word. You need but touch the heart and I'll go. You see, God has a hard time sending the unwilling. He can. He can drag you out of right where you are. But he would prefer us to be obedient. And it's not about getting. Abraham got some wonderful things. God made him a great nation. God blessed him personally. And God gave him a name that still resounds today. But it was more so about giving. To be a blessing to others. To be a blessing to other families. That's what it's all about. What is God's calling on your life tonight, right at this moment? It is not just to sit here in church, go home, live a normal life, then come back on Wednesday night, live a normal life, and come back on Sunday morning. There's got to be more to it than that. And there is more to it than that. But you're not going to find it in the world. You're going to find it in the Word. And you'll find it in your heart when you seek Him. Jeremiah 33:3 is God's phone number. It says, call unto me, and I will answer thee, God says, and show thee great and mighty things that thou knowest not. You want to know what God's calling is on your life? You call upon Him. And you surrender your life to Him and accept the promises He'll give you because He'll bless you more than you ever can fathom. First calling upon your life is to salvation. God calls all. As I said a while ago out of 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning His promises, but He's long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. God wants everybody to be saved. And if you do not get saved, it's your own fault. Because the Lord Jesus Christ has already done everything it takes to be saved except for your surrendering to Him. He's already paid the price that you can't pay. And He did it for one simple reason. Because He loves us. Nothing more, nothing less. He loves us. And He desires us to love Him back. But for those of us who are Christians, have you heard the command of God? Through it comes the promises. And are you being obedient to His call for your life? Let us pray.